Hello, everybody. I just want to make an announcement, kind of an update on what we're doing in the church situation with the coronavirus. The church council has met a joint church council meeting with Our Blessed Savior and St. John, and the council has decided to open in-person worship starting this coming Sunday, August the 2nd. It will be at the usual time, but it will not be necessarily the usual service. We will not have singing. We will not have fellowship or passing the peace, obviously. There will be several things in the service that are different, but we are going to have communion. We'll have songs that can be hummed. We will have a sermon, and we will have some prayers and liturgy. So it will be different, but we are going to have in-person worship. And I want to make sure that all of you know who are concerned about coming to this kind of worship, that David and Carol Shears have decided that they will continue to produce the quality half-hour service that we now have on YouTube and on the internet. So if you have any qualms about showing up at all, don't come and just watch us online or on YouTube. The other thing is that people will have to wear masks and people will have to be spaced in the church. We'll have to use good sense and good safety in doing that. So I think, you know, it's good that we're going to be able to come back to worship, although some will choose not to, and that is perfectly okay. And we hope to see you next Sunday and the Sundays after. So now, without further ado, we prepare for our worship service.
Pray with me the prayer of the day for the eighth Sunday after Pentecost. Beloved and sovereign God, through the death and resurrection of your Son, you bring us into your kingdom of justice and mercy. By your Spirit, give us your wisdom that we may treasure the life that comes from Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The first reading is from 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 5 through 12. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, although I am only a small child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous that they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you." Psalm 119, verses 129 through 136. Your decrees are wonderful, therefore I obey them with all my heart. When your word is opened, it gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant because I long for your commandments. Turn to me and be gracious to me, as you always do to those who love your name. Order my footsteps in your word. Let no iniquity have dominion over me. Rescue me from those who oppress me, and I will keep your commandments. Let your face shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears because people do not keep your teaching. The second reading is from Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, "For your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, Echam Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Through your love and through the ram, you saved the son of Abraham. Through the power of your hand, turn the sea into dry land. To the outcast on her knees, you were the God who really sees. And by your might, you set your children. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Echam Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Time of Christ was near, though the people couldn't see what Messiah ought to be. Though your word contained the plan, they just could not understand. Your most awesome work was done through the frailty of your son. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Echam Kana Adonai, I will praise you till I die, El Shaddai.
It is my honor to read for you the gospel, which is from Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 through 33 and 44 through 52. Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He then told another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes out and sells all he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous, and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. Here ends the reading.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Over the 4th of July weekend, I was watching some military kind of film footage, and they were showing World War II stuff, and one of the things that they showed was the Battle of the Bulge, and this was in 1944. The Nazis threw everything they had at the Allies who were advancing into Germany, and they pushed them back, made a big bulge in the line, and it was a pretty desperate fight. And I remember talking to Becky Howard's dad, Chet Ellis, who was there fighting in the Battle of the Bulge, and I was fascinated by some of the things that he said. He said that the winter of 1944 was not a good winter. It was cold, it was snowy, and they could not set up tents because the enemy could spot them. So they had to just dig a hole in the snow, put their slicker down, put a blanket on top of that, lay down and pull a blanket over top of them. And that's the way they slept the entire winter of 1944. A lot of sacrifices in that generation. After the war was done, they had victory parties, and Winston Churchill was attending one. And a guy got up and said that the Battle of the Bulge demonstrated that the British and American soldiers were braver than the German soldiers. And then Winston Churchill got up and he said, no, they were not braver than the German soldiers. They were just brave 5 minutes longer. And in another speech that Winston gave at a boys' school, he gave the commencement address, he got up and said 5 words. He got up and growled, never, never, never give up, and went and sat down. That was it. That's the message from the epistle lesson for today from Romans chapter 8. Never, never, never give up, because God will be with you. There are 3 promises made in this section, in this epistle lesson. The first one is, don't give up. God is still with you. Tie a knot in the end of your rope and hang on. No matter how desperate it is and the battle of the bulge that you're fighting, how bad it is, no matter how bleak it is and how tired and you think you can't go on, don't give up. The Lord is with you. The second promise is that even as we go through these tragedies and terrible things, the Lord is already at work, trying to turn them around and making something still good out of it. The Lord is kind of what I call the great alchemist. He turns lead into gold on a regular basis. The Lord is as good as there has ever been at taking bad situations and bringing something good out of them. The greatest example of which, of course, is Good Friday, Easter Sunday morning. Just when the devil thought he'd done a heck of a trick to kill the Son of God, then God used that for our salvation. Doesn't get any better than that. And I know things in my life that have happened, and I thought, well, you know, I'm done with seminary, but now there's no churches for us, and what am I going to do? And it led me to all these different things of chemical dependency treatment and chaplaincy and nicotine dependency and all of that. And when I look back, I see how God was taking that bad situation and he was still bringing something good out of it eventually. At the time, I didn't see that and it was pretty painful, but I see it now. I read a story about Pastor Tony Campolo. He does a lot of work with college-age students, campus crusade kind of things. And he told a story of a young woman who came to one of his presentations. And she came up and she was tearful and she was surrendered herself and gave herself to the Lord. And about 3 years later, Tony was able to meet her parents. And they told this story. They said that their daughter was really going down a bad road. Drugs, sex, crazy stuff, rebellion. And they were just despondent over what would happen. And then she, 2 days after she went to this thing, unbeknownst to them, then she was killed in a car accident. And of course, they were hopeless at the funeral because they knew she was lost. And then the day after the funeral, they got a letter in the mail from their daughter who said, "I have just given my life to the Lord, and I am asking for your forgiveness and seeking your reconciliation, and I'm on my way home to ask for your forgiveness in person." It didn't minimize the loss of their daughter. She was still gone. But these parents now at least had hope that their daughter was not lost. She was with the Lord. She was in the best hands she could possibly be, and they would see her again. Yes, they missed her, but they had hope. They knew that they would see her and she was okay. And so there was something good brought out of this tragedy. And the same thing can happen to us too. The third promise in the lesson is that God will never stop loving you. It is not in him to quit loving you and I. There is something about us. We are a part of him, and he is a part of us, and he cannot not love us. No matter what we do or how far we go, the Lord cannot stop loving us. He just thinks we're great. If he had a refrigerator, our picture would be up on his refrigerator and our photo would be in his wallet. He just can't get enough of us. And that's why my favorite parable is another one that Jesus told about the prodigal son, or probably a better title would be The Loving and Forgiving Father and Two Lost Sons. You remember how the story goes. Young son comes to his father and he says, "Father, give me my share of the inheritance that belongs to me," which was a real slap in the face in that culture. It was the same thing as saying, "Dad, I wish you'd drop dead right now," because that's the only way you get inheritance normally. The father should have, by rights, boxed his ears and sent them out in the field to work, but he loved him, and he said, okay, and he gave him his share of the inheritance, which he piddled away with riotous living, whatever that is, but I've got a pretty good idea. And then there was a big famine that arose, and he had nothing, so He hired on to feed pigs for a farmer. And for a young Jewish boy, does it get any worse than that, an unclean animal feeding pigs? Well, yeah, it does. He actually was eating the pods that the pigs were eating. He might as well just go put his face down in the trough and eaten with the pigs. It doesn't get any worse than that. And so finally he came to himself and goes, "What am I doing here? My dad has food and to spare. I've got it. A new and dumber life plan. I'll go back and just say, I know I can't be a son, but let me be a hired man. I'll just go live in the bunkhouse with the boys and maintain my false pride." So he heads back, repent, to turn around. But he's not really repenting. He's just got another dumber life plan. But while he was yet afar off, his father saw him and ran out to meet him. And do you know how it was that his father just happened to see him while he was yet afar off? It was because he was looking for him every day, every single day. He was looking for him, hoping against hope that he would come to his senses and turn around and be a son. And so he ran out to meet him and threw his arms around him and stopped the dumb life plan that the son was going to put out there and said, "Bring a ring, bring a robe, put it on him. This is not a hired man, this is a son." And of course, the other son was jealous of that, and he wouldn't go into the party. And now the father has to go out a second time for a second son in another costly demonstration of love. But that's who God is to us. He just can't get enough of you and me. He just has to love us because we're part of him. And so those are the three promises that we have. To hang on because God is still in control and he will be with us and send the Spirit to give us strength and comfort us. The Spirit who intercedes with sighs too deep for words. He will be there with us to go through it. Maybe he won't dip us out of the trouble, but he'll go through it with us. And secondly, he is already there taking bad things and turning them around and still managing to bring something good out of that. And thirdly, he just can't stop loving us. It's who he is, and it's who we are to him. So listen again to the last words of our lesson for today. Listen to the power in this that we have in our relationship with God. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Take myself.